Hello friends, I welcome all of you to my new lecture on drugs acting on autonomic nervous system. So here we have been discussing about various aspects of adrenergic system. So here in this session we will see in detail about adrenergic agonists. Here we will see beta selective agonistic drugs. In this category we will have so many drugs in the beta 2 adrenergic receptor agonistic category, which are very much famous for their application in asthma management. So in this, let's see in brief what exactly are beta 2 adrenergic receptors, and then we'll go to the drugs category. Beta 2 adrenergic receptors are found on a number of cell types within the lungs, including epithelial cells, submucosal glands, vascular endothelium, vascular smooth muscle, and inflammatory cells, including mast cells, macrophages, and eosinophils. So, beta adrenergic receptor distribution is wide in our system. Beta adrenergic receptors are obviously GPCRs, and in fact, these are the first GPCRs to be cloned. In Chinese medicine, ephedrine containing plant mahuang was used to alleviate respiratory conditions, especially the bronchial smooth muscle relaxation, asthma-like conditions. So here, in the latter phases, the scientists found that ephedrine activates beta-2 adrenergic pathway indirectly via increasing the activity of noradrenaline at beta-adrenergic receptors. And later on, scientists found this is the first ever drug to be approved for beta-2 agonistic activity, salbutamol. Let's see in brief about the beta-2 adrenergic receptor and its role in asthma. So this is the basic setup of beta-2 adrenergic receptor, GPCR. So this is the GPCR, this is inhibitory GPCR, which is connected to adenyl cyclase. So here we have an ion channel. So this is the sarcoplasmic reticulum, because beta-adrenergic receptor is connected to smooth muscle. So in smooth muscle, calcium is reserved. Calcium reserves are present within sarcoplasmic reticulum. So here, when beta-2 agonists activate beta-2 adrenergic receptor site, it activates adenylyl cyclase activity, so thereby it increases cyclic AMP level. So which upon this activates protein kinase A, which has dual activity. So it activates calcium dependent potassium channel, so thereby potassium efflux will be there. It also phosphorylates inositol triphosphate receptor present on sarcoplasmic reticulum. So thereby it reduces positive charge within the cell, which is what we call it as hyperpolarization of the cell. All these will end up in ultimate relaxation of the smooth muscle. So here, when we activate muscarinic receptors present on lung epithelium or the smooth muscles, the same kind of mechanism ensures relaxation of smooth muscle. So in case of asthma, when allergens are there, whatever the allergen may be, when it is attached to mast cells, what happens? It releases interleukins, means chemokine signaling mechanism. So interleukins attaches onto interleukin receptor present on bronchial smooth muscle. It activates phospholipase C. So what does it do? Phospholipase C increases, destroys phosphoinositol diphosphate to inositol triphosphate and diacyl glycerol. Okay, so diacyl glycerol mechanism. So where phosphoinositol triphosphate switches on the calcium channel present on sarcoplasmic reticulum, and diacyl glycerol enhances activity of phosphokinase C. So this phosphokinase C phosphorylates calponin and MLCK, means myosin light chain kinase enzyme, activates both these. So all these, it initiates a cascade of events which ultimately ends up in contraction. So muscarinic M3 receptors mechanism on smooth muscle is also the same. So this is the sequence which actually ensures contraction of the smooth muscle. So beta-2 agonists, they help in the smooth muscle relaxation by activating beta-2 adrenergic receptor site and cyclic AMP level, enhancing cyclic AMP level in this way. So in case of beta-adrenergic receptors, as I told you, this is one of the oldest receptors scientists studied, and we have oldest drugs like ephedrine in this category. So hundreds of drugs were synthesized for their efficacy on beta to adrenergic agonists, which resulted in three major types of drugs. One is short-acting beta to adrenergic agonist, or SABA. In the their duration of activity is around 4 to 6 hours. The second one is long acting. In long acting category, almost 12 hours activity duration will be there. In case of ultra long acting, the duration will go up to 24 hours, because as I told you earlier, this is meant for asthma. In case of asthmatic attacks, a patient needs to have 24 hour protection. So that's why scientists have tried for obtaining ultra long acting beta to adrenergic agonists. So in SABA category, we have these drugs: albuterol, pirbuterol, terbutal, and even salbutamol is also a short acting beta to adrenergic agonist. In case of long acting, we have salmeterol and formoterol. In ultra long acting, we have indacaterol and vilanterol. So these are the drugs that we have over here. If you closely observe their structures, on the left hand side, the aromatic ring, as well as the junction between aromatic ring and nitrogen, there is hardly any change. Yes, sir. Okay, so here on the right hand side, on the substitutions on nitrogen, if you observe, in case of short acting, we have smaller or less crowded or less lipophilic units are there. As we move from long acting to ultra long acting, the length of the chain and the lipophilicity is significantly increasing. So that is one reason why it has more absorption and more T half value within the system. It is staying within the system. It could be one reason. So this is the way how we have different types of beta to adrenergic agonists in the clinical practice. Now let's see a few examples. Salbutamol, if you observe the structure, aromatic ring, so this unit is actually salicyl alcohol containing drug, so salbutamol. So what is this one? Tertiary butyl unit, salicyl alcohol, salbutamol. Okay, so this is the oldest beta 2 agonist approved, and this has a very quick onset of action, 4 to 10 minutes, and a very short duration, that is 4 to 6 hours, and use it for the management of acute asthmatic symptoms. And because it is only like a symptomatic relief only it can give you, and a chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. So these are the two diseases where the drug is prescribed. It is used as or an inhaler, by using an inhaler. Side effects are too many: palpitations, tachycardia, excitement, hyperactivity, insomnia, nervousness, shakiness, and unpleasant taste at the site of ingestion. So amongst all these, shakiness is so peculiar that patient will suffer from shakiness in hands especially. Right now, salbutamol formulations are available in the market, but they are dominated by more recent formulations like valnitrolol. Bitalterol is again another drug molecule, which is actually a prodrug of colterol, and this is also a quick onset and short duration, or SABA type of class of drug. It is used for the management of acute asthmatic attacks and COPD. Now let's see a little bit on beta 2 adrenergic agonists. My friends, beta 2 adrenergic receptors category, very less drugs are available, and these are only emergency medicines. Largely they are emergency medicines, especially used in ICUs. One of the drugs is dopamine. Dopamine is a very simple molecule. It is a neurochemical present in our body. So you may be wondering why dopamine is actually given for heart, because as I told you earlier also, none of the molecules that are chemotransmitters in our body, chemical signaling molecules in our body, can be used as a general drug molecule, because like in case of adrenaline, noradrenaline, acetylcholine or dopamine, they are synthesized and released locally at the nerve junctions as and when it is needed. Adrenaline is the only chemical which is, adrenaline and noradrenaline are the only chemicals which are synthesized and released directly into the blood, okay, by the adrenal cortex. Except that we don't have any other drug which is synthesized and released. So hence dopamine is actually, it has a large activity in CNS, central nervous system. But when dopamine is given systemically, intravenous, dopamine is a highly polar molecule, water soluble, so it cannot cross blood-brain barrier, so it will not show any kind of CNS activity. It activates its specific receptors and dilates renal blood vessels. It enhances beta-1 adrenergic activity by direct and indirect mechanisms. It is used to maintain blood pressure in conditions like shock, trauma and chronic heart failure. Because all these three are emergency kind of situations where acute loss in blood pressure will lead to fatality. To reverse these conditions, dopamine is used systemically. Orally, it is not active because dopamine is quickly metabolized by COMT. Okay? And monoamine oxidase enzyme. So that's why we, in order to escape from the metabolism, to increase its usage, IV fluids are given. It is given intravenous route as a drip. The next one is dobutamine. It is an aryl alkyl derivative of dopamine. So here, if you observe, this part is actually dopamine, and this is actually is attached to this nitrogen. And here, whenever we have alpha methyl group, okay, so it does two things. One is it enhances alpha adrenergic activity. Second one is it prevents its metabolism by MAO, monoamino oxidase enzyme. So here, because this is a chiral structure, S minus isomer shows agonistic activity on alpha 1 and beta 1 receptors. So there is something unique in this. R plus isomer shows antagonistic activity on alpha 1 and agonistic activity on beta 1 and beta 2 receptors. If you see these two are almost equipotent on alpha 1 receptor. So here alpha, this shows agonistic activity. S shows agonistic activity and R shows antagonistic activity. So when a racemic mixture is given, it shows only, because alpha 1 agonistic and antagonistic activity cancel each other, so only beta receptor activity only remains. The racemic mixture shows pronounced beta 1 agonistic activity. So this is so unique, and it is used for reviving heart in the treatment of heart failure, and very short duration of action and orally not useful. So friends, this is all about beta adrenergic agonistic drugs. So I'll see you again in my next lecture on alpha adrenergic agonists and other drugs in this chapter. Thank you all for your patient listening. See you all again in the next lecture. Thank you.